morning.
Good morning.
Today we hear a reminder that our good Lord has chosen us to live for Him. We'll begin with the first hymn. Of the Holy Spirit. Before we praise our triune God for working faith in our hearts and keeping us in Him, let us remember why Jesus had to die to pay for our sins. Therefore, let us confess our sins to God our Father, asking Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins. And trusting in my Savior Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given His only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by His authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And with that, children, if you would come forward. So, kids, what do you suppose we have in this box here? Maybe I should peek in. Huh? You think so? Did you see it?
I saw a light.
Oh, you saw a light. light. Well, that seems strange, isn't it? Something really important, something to use, especially if the electricity goes out.
A flashlight.
A flashlight. Ooh, not a candle. That would be pretty bad, wouldn't it? I could burn this whole place down. Yeah, but here's the strange part. Look at there. It's already lit. Now, why would you put a flashlight in a box but have it lit? That wouldn't make much sense, would it? Because as soon as you close it up, it doesn't give light to anybody, does it? Huh. No. With a flashlight, you have to make sure you have it out so that you can actually see where you're going, especially at night. Well, this should remind us of something else. The Lord Jesus tells us that you and I are the light of the world. What that means is he's already lit up our life by telling us he lived for us and then he died for us on the cross. He paid for all of our sins. You and I know that. And so now we're the lights of the world to make sure other people also hear about Jesus, the light of the world, huh? We're supposed to be the ones that not only remind ourselves of Jesus, but also remind all the rest of them, huh? Tell them all about Jesus. But if we keep it all locked up inside of us, then it's not going to do anybody else any good, is it? Jesus doesn't want us to keep it all locked up in ourselves. No, he wants us to share all about him with other people, since they don't know about Jesus necessarily. So, with that, keep Jesus in mind in your own hearts, but also keep sharing him with others. Well, what do you know? We have some candy here, but I'll tell you, I would not recommend you have the candy while you have the thumb in your mouth. It won't work at all. Although it might give you a new flavor. You're welcome.
Thank you.
Mmm, that smells good. On hearing God's word, the Israelites gladly promised to obey all that God commanded them to do, which, of course, we know they did not. Our Old Testament lesson is recorded in Exodus chapter 19, beginning with the first verse. On the first day of the third month after the Israelites left Egypt, on that very day they came to the desert of Sinai. After they set out from Rephidim, they entered the desert of Sinai, and Israel camped there in the desert in front of the mountain. Then Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain and said, "This is what you are to say to the descendants of Jacob and what you are to tell the people of Israel. You yourselves have seen what I did to Egypt, and how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all nations you will be my treasured possession. Although the whole earth is mine, you will be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words you are to speak to the Israelites." So Moses went back and summoned the elders of the people and set before them all the words of the Lord had commanded him to speak. The people all responded together, "We will do everything the Lord has said." This is the word of God. First, Jesus tells us that it's just a natural part of being a Christian to show our faith to others by the good things we do. Then he reminds us that all those good things do not in any way earn us heaven. Faith in Jesus does that. Good deeds help others get there by pointing them to our Savior God. Our gospel lesson for today is recorded in Matthew's gospel account, chapter 5, beginning with the 13th verse. Please rise for the words and works of the Lord Jesus. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled on by men. You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. I tell you the truth, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of the pen, will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished. Anyone who breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever practices and teaches these commands will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven. This is the word of God. We pray. Almighty God, you sent your one and only Son as the word of life for our eyes to see and our ears to hear. Help us believe what the scriptures proclaim about him and do the things that are pleasing in your sight. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And you may be seated as we sing the next hymn. Rise from onward,
Hallelujah.
Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The word of God that we'll consider is the epistle lesson for this Sunday, recorded in Peter's first epistle, chapter 2, beginning with the 9th verse. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you have not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Dear friends, I urge you as foreigners and exiles to abstain from sinful desires which wage war against your soul. Live such good lives among the pagans that, though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us. This is the word of God. Dear friends in Christ Jesus, today we install some of you men as church councilmen, devoting your life to serving the Lord in the way that he has chosen you to serve him. But in a way, we could say the same thing of all of us here. The Lord has chosen all of us to serve him in specific ways and to serve him and others in that way. This will become all the more apparent as we take a look at what Peter has for us today. As he says to us, live for the Lord who chose you. At this time of the year, we don't usually think about picking fruits and vegetables, at least not here in the North Country. But nonetheless, it wasn't so long ago that those of us who do some gardening think about things like that. The fact is that we not only pick the fruits and vegetables, but as gardeners, we have to do a lot more things than that. First of all, we've got to think about what we're going to plant and where we're going to plant those things. Then we tend to those young plants and nurture them to make sure the day will come when we're also able to pick the fruit or vegetables and then either eat them immediately or pack them away so we have something in midwinter when we can't be picking the fruits and vegetables. Well, in a way, God has done this very same thing with us. From eternity, he decided to choose you and me to live at a certain place at a certain time and serve him and others at that specific time and place. Paul tells us, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. God chose us to be part of his garden before he even created the garden. And no, that doesn't mean we were already alive from eternity, as some people take from that. No, not at all. It means rather that God knew in advance that he was going to create you and me, and then he was going to have you and me in his garden at this specific time, so that he would also harvest certain fruits and vegetables from us serving him. In other words, that we will reach out to still others. So let's take a few moments today to consider what Peter was telling the Jew and Gentile Christians alike, as he also addresses us the same way. And first of all, then, consider how God chose you. In Old Testament times, God chose the Israelites to be his special people. And among the Israelites, he also chose a certain man by the name of Hosea to be one of his prophets. He gave Hosea a rather strange special assignment, however. In our Old Testament lesson for today, we heard how the Israelites promised to be faithful to the Lord and do everything he commanded. And we know that within 40 days of that, even as they were gathered there at Mount Sinai and had the best of intentions, they figured Moses went up on the mountain and died up there. So they decided to make and worship a golden calf instead. God had called them to be his special people, and already they deserted him. That said, the Israelites never really changed throughout their history, never changed for the better. They continued to sin against the Lord God and against each other. Hundreds of years later, Hosea was called to show God's people how they had deserted the true God. The Lord always viewed his Old Testament people as his bride, and he was the groom. They were married to one another, only the Israelites were unfaithful in their marriage to the Lord God. To demonstrate that to the Israelites, the Lord commanded Hosea to marry a prostitute. And then, when the first child was born after they were married, the Lord told him to name the child, "Not My People." They had another child, but we can already see what's happening here. "Not My People." Can you imagine what Hosea felt like at that moment? Name your kid "Not My Child." Ouch! It was obvious Gomer, his wife, was being unfaithful to him. And the next child was to be not loved. I can't imagine what it was like for the children to have to live with names like that for their life, but that was what the Lord had commanded. In other words, the life of Hosea was to be a demonstration of how God's people had committed adultery against him and were not faithful spouses to him. Well, you and I need to ask ourselves, are we so much better? Just as Hosea named the child "Not My People," Peter tells us, "Once you were not a people." Just as Hosea named a child "not loved," so Peter says, "Once you had not received mercy," you had not received God's unfailing love toward you. And why is that? Well, because as you and I declare with David, "Surely I have been sinful from birth, sinful from the time my mother had conceived me," we are admitting that we were born into this world estranged from God. Paul tells us the sinful mind is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those controlled by the sinful nature cannot please God. So, by our very nature, by the very way that you and I were conceived and born, we were not faithful in the marriage with God. Rather, we were his hostile enemies. That's what God tells us in his word. But consider how God sees you now. Peter says that very thing, that's what you were. But now you are the people of God, and how you have received mercy. then he describes what that means for you and for me. He says we are a chosen people. God not only loved the world that he gave his son to live and die for us all, he loves you in particular and chose you to be his very own family member. He says, you are a royal priesthood. You're not just part of any family. You're part of the king's royal family. God's Old Testament people were his chosen people, but they still had to go to prophets and kings and to priests in order to talk to the Lord first, and then hear from them what God had to say to them. But God changed all that for us New Testament Christians. Jesus, our mediator, says, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give it to you. So, as councilman, you have been commissioned for serving in the positions that you are for the next 3 years. But as Christians, all of us have been commissioned to serve a lifelong ministry of serving the Lord and each other, just as God wants to use us, in whatever way he wants to use us. He says, you are a holy nation. God set aside you as his people, more than Israel ever could be. They could never measure up to the promises that they had made to God. But on the other hand, God tells us that we've been robed in Christ's righteousness, in his perfection. God sees us as part of the communion of saints now. All of his holy people made holy in Christ. Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. That's how God sees you and me now. And God says that we are his special possession. You know, studies show that these days it's very important to people in our day to belong to others, to be part of a community, to see a church, for instance, not as some organization or club, but rather as a family of believers. To be part of that kind of closeness. That's what people long for. Now, if it's special to them to belong to an outward organization and call that a family of believers, how much more precious is it to be part of God's family, to be part of that special family? The fact is that Jesus shed his blood not just for everybody else, but for you. Today, we're also reminded of that in a special way in the sacrament, where he gives us his own body and blood and with the bread and wine of Holy Communion, given and poured out for you individually. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. With such good news that God chose you to be his very own, we should consider how God wants you to live. The Lord, through the Apostle Peter, wants us to turn away from the tempting thoughts of thinking that somehow the most important thing in life is whatever we can get for ourselves. Everything that the world considers important. Everything that the world offers to us. Instead, we should think of ourselves, he says, as foreigners and exiles. For me, thinking of me personally, it might be easy to think that the retirement house that we built, I know this is a little dated, there's a few changes to the sense of, but that retirement house that we built is now the end all. Oh, it's a place we can go and we'll have everything we need or want. Well, the fact is that I remember a pastor that I had many, many years ago who described this wonderful little house that he and his wife had always dreamt of having. A nice little Cape Cod house with a lawn fence around the front and some nice shutters on the windows. And they always dreamt of having that in retirement. And what do you know? They found the house, even right down to the shutters. And a month after they moved in, he died suddenly, unexpectedly. So much for that. You see, the fact is that as soon as we start thinking about all the things that we might have in this world, we don't know how long we'll have any of those things. My grandchildren didn't really like it when I told them one day, well, by when my parents died and their parents, I've got roughly 15 years, if the Lord wants me to live that long. They didn't want to hear it. I was just looking at it realistically. God's got it all in mind. He knows. But every single one of us needs to realize having food and clothing, we will be content with that. Or to think, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall lack nothing. That means nothing as far as having anything else except where I need to stay and food, whatever I need for life, as long as the Lord wants to give me life. Every one of us needs to realize that. And in Peter's time, the pagans, the unbelievers, were many times confiscating the Christians' property, taking it for themselves or destroying it. Well, it's still happening in our world today to Christians around the world, except not so much here in America. But it may happen here too. We don't know. With the doctrinal positions that our church body has taken concerning issues, it wouldn't surprise me at all if in my lifetime yet, our churches wouldn't have to wind up paying tax on our church properties. It wouldn't surprise me at all if they would even take our churches away from us or ban our churches. The way America is going today, where it's going farther and farther away from our constitutional rights and freedoms, it seems like it's only a matter of time before sooner or later we're going to wind up like the Christians of China. You know, the Christian in China thought it was really a wonderful thing when they got those wonderful ringtone doorbells. After all, you can see who's coming up to your place, even when you're not there. It's wonderful to have those cameras inside the house to make sure that you catch if any robber is inside your home. Well, yeah, the Chinese thought that was wonderful. But now the Chinese government controls all those cameras and watches every single house every single day. to make sure that Christians are not even meeting in house churches without the government knowing it. In fact, a lot of the Christian churches in China have wound up to be nothing but rubble. Is that coming for us? We don't know. Just a friendly little weather balloon flying over America this past week. Did you see it got shot down? We waited until it was over the ocean. Okay, never mind. Fact is, we just don't know what the future holds, but thank God he does. And it only means it's good for us. The fact is that there's a much bigger battle that you and I face than what will happen with the Chinese or anybody else. And that battle is going on inside of us every single day. Peter says, abstain from sinful desires which wage war against your soul. You know, he's trying to remind us to think long term instead of instant gratification. Instant gratification involves drugs and alcohol and sex and lust and violence and so many other things that try to make us think that they're a quick fix. Try to think long term. Realize we are foreigners and exiles here on this earth. Believers in the past admitted that they were aliens and strangers on earth, and they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. As we grow in our Christian faith, we'll learn to say no to the instant and yes to the long term. The fact is we died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? But we also can see another reason why Peter is saying, say no to instant gratification. Live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and praise God on the day he visits us. We all know that God wants us to witness concerning our faith to the ever-increasing number of unchurched people that even live in our own neighborhoods, maybe right next door to us. God wants us to be the ones that tell the ungodly how much they need the Christian faith just as much as you and I do. Yet I've observed in our Wisconsin Evangelical Lutheran Synod over the years that while we are so confident that our sins are forgiven in Christ Jesus, we are so confident in it that we figure, well, we can just go ahead and sin anyway because God will forgive us. Now, that's not the way he wants us to live. And since, statistically again, one-third or more of the people that are unchurched now believe that Christianity is a detriment to society and want to get rid of it in any way possible. That's right here in America. One-third. Obviously, that means they're looking for any chance they can to say, aha, by your ungodly living, you prove that we're right. You're just a detriment to society. Instead, Peter says, live such good lives that even though they accuse you, they'll see differently. They'll see you as loving and caring. They'll see your integrity and honesty and your respect for others. They'll see how you lovingly care for them, even though they don't want it from you. And they'll reach out, perhaps, to the Lord, as you and I do. People want to see the good lives in us. They don't want to see all the troubles and heartaches. And yet, when you and I do sin, we know we still have someone who forgives us for Jesus' sake. Yeah, that's true. But we'll want to show that love and caring to them so that hopefully they'll turn to the Lord now and praise Him now. But Peter says if that doesn't happen, they will glorify God on the last day when God comes and visits and every knee will bow. Dear friends in Christ, the Lord chose you and me to be His very own. He paid for our sins. He cares for you and me each and every day. Show that love. Live for Him. Amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We sing.
Blessed Jesus, at your word, we are gathered all to hear you. Let our hearts and souls be stirred now to seek and love and fear you. By your teaching, sweet and
dear friends in Christ, St. Paul wrote, just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. Dear brothers, you have been elected to use your gifts in special service in the Lord's kingdom as members of our church council. Our Hoyer president, Nick Gudion, secretary, Paul Moore, elder, Dave Lyons, financial secretary, Chris Collins, treasurer, and Dave Hintz, building and groundsman. I now ask you, in the presence of God and this assembly, will you carry out your responsibilities faithfully to the glory of Christ and in service to his church? If so, answer, I will, and I ask God to help me.
I will, and I ask God to help me.
Will you, brothers, support and pray for the pastor and fellow members of Christus Evangelical Lutheran Church and your fellow councilmen in this work? If so, answer, we will, and we ask God to help us.
We will, and we ask God to help us.
I now install you as councilman and elder of Christus Evangelical Lutheran Church in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Almighty Father, giver of health, we pray for Darlene Pino, who suffered a minor stroke this past week, as well as for any others who may be sick or suffering. Grant that in the midst of strife or pain, they may be comforted by your presence and sustained in your loving arms. If it be your gracious will, restore her and them to health, that they may soon worship you here with us again. Gracious Father, you call your people to service and give them various tasks in the world and in your church. Send down on these workers your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the spirit of counsel and of might, the spirit of the knowledge and fear of the Lord. Grant grace and strength that they may serve you faithfully to the glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who has also taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Go then and take up the work to which you have been elected. May the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. The Lord Almighty bless us and direct our days and our deeds in his peace. Amen. You may go. And in the name of our congregation, we sincerely thank Russ Carroll, Jonathan Stanell, and Ron Lang, and Paul Moore, who have served the Lord and their church in a position of leadership in the past years. May the Lord our God graciously reward them for their services done to his glory and for the benefit of his church. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. We conclude now with the final hymn.
Let me be yours forever. Lord, do not let me weary.
I guess they decided with that familiar hymn that they'd throw a few twists in. I should have had the hymnal so I could have gotten the right beat on that one, but oh well. If you notice, they also changed On Eagle's Wings somewhat for the last verse, just for good measure, but oh well. And we didn't even sing it quite the way it is in the new hymnal. They also have an extra refrain at the end, which is slower. So I thought it might be a little difficult to see that on the screen unless we put down the notes. Anyway, we're glad you could be here today. Please note the announcements. Yes, we're still on Revelation, but we're getting very close to being done. How about that? I promised everyone I would be done with it before we leave here, and yeah, that's true. to be fair, if you all gave me the 45 minutes that supposedly I have, it would make a lot of difference on how fast we would have gotten up. But I'm glad for the fellowship, too. Please also note, I should call attention, the ladies, you have a meeting on Saturday. Actually, I have two Bible information classes, one on Monday and one on Friday as well. So, and I believe those are all the announcements. Have yourself a good day. There's the food. You make the fellowship.